All right, so welcome. We're going to get going here. We'll probably have some folks join us as we go. So I'm Dave Ferguson, professor of landscape architecture at Ball State. I'm also an instructor in the Master of Urban Design program, which is based here at the Ball State Indy Center. And we want to give a special thanks to Ball State's Master of Urban Design program and Michelle Munyar, who runs it, for hosting us tonight. Quick orientation, restrooms, lobby, left, in the back. Food you've probably already found. So we conceived this idea, and we hope that this will be part of a series, but we conceived it as a way to start a conversation about the massive and sometimes very dramatic threats and opportunities that are facing our cities, our society over the next several decades. And we thought that by identifying some major trends and then dreaming of ideal responses for our urban areas, that we could accelerate innovation here, and that we would maybe open ourselves up to new forms of city development. So that's the idea behind this night. So we structured tonight's event in the form of a moderated panel. We have assembled, in my opinion, some of the best visionary thinkers that the city has to offer. And I'm amazed that we got them all in one place at one time, because they have literally the busiest schedules of pretty much anybody I know. So really thankful for that. We purposely chose these guys because they come from diverse backgrounds and perspectives. We didn't want all kind of an architectural perspective or a single perspective, single discipline. So we have a cross section, as you'll see when I share their bios. And they're all bold innovators in their areas of endeavor, and that was something that we thought was really important. So in a few minutes, I'm going to share a few slides about those looming threats and opportunities that our cities have to respond to, and then that'll be followed by our panelists reacting to some of those trends, and then sharing some of their own dreams regarding how this city might be reformed over the next several decades in response to what we're seeing on the horizon. But first, let me do some introductions. And I'm going to spend a few minutes telling you who these folks are. I felt it was important for you to see the depth and the breadth of their backgrounds. You may know these guys, but I'm guessing there are a few facts in these bios that you would not know. So we'll start with Kristian Andersen. Kristian works with entrepreneurs and business leaders to design compelling brand experiences, to create new business models, to innovate new products and services. So he is the entrepreneur's entrepreneur. And if you know anything about the startup community, you've seen Kristian in action. So he co-founded High Alpha, a new venture studio recently. And that studio conceives, operates, and scales enterprise cloud companies. But he also founded and serves as CEO of Studio Science, just down the street on the circle, a design and innovation consultancy. He's also an active angel investor, co-founded Gravity Ventures, a seed stage venture fund that invests in tech-focused startups. He's also the co-founder of several startups, including Tinderbox, Lessonly, Visible VC, and Path Agility. And he advises many more companies. He's a board member on several of those startups and nonprofits, and he also co-founded The Speakeasy, which most of you probably know, and also Indie Made. And he serves as a mentor at the Iron Yard, Run-Up Labs, and the ARC Challenge Accelerators. One of the most remarkable things about Kristian, in my opinion, is that he has successfully, for the past decade or so, split his time between Indianapolis and Arkansas, outside of Little Rock, where he has been building a sustainable lifestyle with his wife and six kids. So, interesting guy, lots to bring to the table. Next is Jeff Kingsbury. Jeff is managing principal of Greenstreet Limited, which is an Indianapolis-based strategic planning and real estate practice that focuses on sustainable strategies and redevelopment of urban places. His experience includes over 25 years in planning and development of communities across the United States, and he's been a principal in the development and disposition of over $350 million in real estate. He's consulted on planning, economic development, regulatory, and implementation issues for private sector clients, municipalities, nonprofits in 16 states, as well as internationally. He's also been a senior advisor to Cherokee, which is the leading private equity firm focused on brownfield redevelopment with more than $2 billion under management. Jeff graduated from Ball State's College of Architecture and Planning with degrees in urban planning and development and environmental design. He's also served as an adjunct faculty in urban planning at the college. For Washington, D.C. based Urban Land Institute, which many of you may know, Jeff has chaired the Redevelopment and Reuse Council, the Sustainable Development Council, and served on the Institute's Advisory Committee on Climate Change, Land Use, and Energy, as well as the Global Awards for Excellence jury. And he's also co-author of the book, Developing Sustainable Planned Communities. So again, rich background to draw on.
And Dave was on my thesis committee.
Yes.
So we go back, way back.
We go back a few years, yes. So then we have Brian Payne. So Brian Payne is president and CEO of the $700 million Central Indiana Community Foundation and the Indianapolis Foundation. Since he joined CICF in November 2000, the foundation's annual grant making has doubled to almost $50 million. The foundation has a major focus in developing, attracting, and retaining highly educated, creative, entrepreneurial, and community-minded people. And their focus is supported by three major initiatives: family success, college readiness and success, and inspiring places. And tonight we're definitely focused on inspiring places. He's also the founder of the Indianapolis Cultural Trail, a legacy of Gene and Marilyn Glick. As I'm sure all of you know, that 8 mile, $63 million cultural trail connects every significant arts, cultural, heritage, sports, and entertainment venue in downtown Indianapolis. The National Urban Design Group Project for Public Spaces chose the Indianapolis Cultural Trail as, quote, the best North American example of a big, bold, transformative project that is changing the way we think of cities and city life. He speaks nationally and internationally. His themes have included thriving cities, inspiring places, trails and parks, livability, competitiveness, and talent attraction and retention. And he's spoken at many national conferences, including American Planning Association, CEOs for Cities, Larger Community Foundations Annual Conference, Council of Foundations, and United Way. He's also had multiple honors, including the Indiana Citizen Planner of the Year. Before moving from California to make his home in Indianapolis in 1993, he was managing director of Shakespeare Santa Cruz and worked for several theater producing organizations in Southern California, including the 1984 Los Angeles Olympic Arts Festival. And he received both his MFA and Bachelor of Arts from UCLA. So, different backgrounds, different points of view, different amazing accomplishments, but coming at the city from a variety of ways and manners. So that's what we really wanted to start to prime tonight. So with that intro, and thank you guys, by the way, this is
wonderful.
Just wanted to share 10 things that are facing us. There are many more, I'm sure, but these will be ones that I think you'll agree belong on the list. These are things that if we do not respond to in an aggressive and proactive way, we'll find ourselves, unfortunately, reacting probably much too late. So this is I think of it as a pivot point, as a place where the cities that are going to thrive in the future will be thinking about these things now and beginning to identify where we want to be and attempt to reverse engineer from this point. So we're really targeting that 2040, 2050 time frame. So that's quite a ways out. It's really difficult, as most of you know, to be a futurist and get it right more than 10 years out, but we'll do our best to kind of anticipate. So number one, population growth. This is pretty astounding. Again, it may be something you're familiar with, but if you stop and reflect on it, it's a sobering thought. Some charts are showing that we may have upwards of 11 billion people on the planet by 2050. That's a 45% increase in population over where we are today. Think about the stresses that we're under now because of population. And by 2050, 70% of the world's going to be in cities. So the city becomes more important than it's ever been in history. So that's just a starting point in a context. Climate change, don't need to spend a whole lot of time because I think we all understand, given what we're seeing in weather and the rise in the ocean, melting of the Arctic ice, that we are in for some interesting rides coming down the road. The impact on the Midwest, this is from NASA, extreme heat, heavy downpours and flooding that will affect infrastructure, health, agriculture, forestry, transportation, air and water quality, etc. All the Great Lakes region will have a range of risks. And what does that mean for us locally? Well, think about waterways and flooding cycles being totally different. Think about volatile weather. Our crops will be reduced in terms of their productivity. Things like wildfire will be more common. And it raises issues about, so do our buildings become more resilient? Do we have to think about architecture differently? Do the landscapes become more responsive, where they fluctuate through these cycles in a more natural way? Can we talk about resilient cities, cities that where the entire city structure is responding in a flexible way? So just a quick word on urban sustainability. Just when you think about what makes up a city, five major building blocks, energy, water, food, shelter, waste, the idea of sustainability is that the dream is that a city might be organized to reduce reliance on the surrounding countryside and distant supply systems and begin to localize production of food, energy, and other resources so that it becomes a bit more self-contained as a successful system. And some of this can happen through feedback loops and sensors and other things that we'll talk about next. So smart cities, Internet of Things. Internet of Things, I think we're all realizing, is a big deal. It's going to be a major shift in the way life happens in our society. So when we think about Internet of Things, it's about sensors. It's about being able to gather information from every aspect of life. And so with those sensors, we get real-time data. When we have real-time data, we have more efficiencies. We can manage our city services better. We can coordinate space better. Something as simple as parking spaces in the city are increasingly being tapped into to create a more fluid environment. And then we have categories, and I won't get into these, but each of these are existing systems that we have on the table right now, where they're apps, they are feedback loops that are solving problems. So we have environment, where we're looking at sensors that monitor environmental conditions like pollution levels, wildlife counts, etc. Safety issues, looking at something like the health of our bridges, sensors that tell us when failure might be close, or something that's a health risk in some of our buildings. Transportation, roadways, streetlights, real-time transit, managing traffic, all of those get easier with the Internet of Things and with sensors helping us with the feedback. Utilities, smart utility grids, being able to parse out energy and manage utilities in a more effective way. And then buildings, smart buildings that have monitoring to track usage, to empower the users to manage their own environment better. So those are all aspects of smart environments, smart cities. And the sensor model kind of looks like this, where we have buildings that are layered within the larger city that are surrounded by intelligent highways, that have intelligent factories, and all of those are functioning and flowing with resources in a much more organic manner. I tend to think of it as nature does this very well. There's no such thing as waste in nature because it becomes a fuel for the next system or the next creature, and that opportunity may be facing us when we start to manage the information flow. Fourth is robots, artificial intelligence. We're seeing a lot of this beginning to be talked about. The idea that that the robot, which is kind of a, my wife's terrified of robots. I mean, it's kind of that idea that, you know, it's not, and Hollywood takes this to certain extremes, but the idea that the robot as a helper can actually learn better ways to help is kind of the idea behind artificial intelligence. So one application is hospitals and medicine. The idea that even something as simple as organizing bed schedules, staff rotations, etc., and the flow of information is something that can get obviously better if you've been in the health system lately. But the idea is that it's just around the corner where we will have that capability, and it will be a self-learning environment. Five is wearable technology, augmented reality, digital fabrication, the idea that what's happening right next to our bodies and in our media surroundings can be affected by the technology. So wearable tech, every person has personal data. Literally, it's being woven into textiles now so that we're having sensors and feedback on things like our health, things like how we're moving through a community, things that we might anticipate as a need. And all of that becomes part of your lifestyle, part of how you move through the city. Digital fabrication and 3D printing makes everyone a maker. So now all of a sudden you can customize what you want in your life as artifact. Six is alternative transportation. So we're starting to hear about driverless cars. We're talking about things like walkable cities that in some cases people are advocating that at least certain portions of the city should be completely carless. But we're also looking at eliminating the car through things like the Hyperloop travel, establishing bike highways that have a more sophisticated approach to how we move people in something other than cars, but also the car itself is going to change. Not just in terms of it being driverless, but they might become stackable. It might be that we no longer own the cars, but we simply are on a shared time environment. And once you start shrinking that, and once you start making the movement of cars and any kind of vehicle through the city more efficient, your streets start to shrink. And then you start to have real estate that you didn't used to have. Your parking lots start to shrink. So what we see happening around the stadium, you know, might all of a sudden have an overabundance of real estate that we now need to develop in a different way. So it opens up possibilities for rethinking the physical environment. Seven, alternative energy and really localized energy. Looking at things like streets that generate solar energy. So these are sections of a bike trail, actually, that are also solar panels. And so they're going to generate energy for the surrounding environment. They're also obviously will power any lighting and such that you need on that trail. The solar and wind turbine movement is here to stay. It's not as efficient as it will be in the future, but we're starting to see pop-up kinds of generation on, you know, this is a Meijer grocery, but they'll start to find their way into lots of common settings. Green roofs are going to be a big move in the next decade. And that'll fight the heat island effect, green walls, and you know, literally seeing buildings that start to become very organic is another aspect. And that list goes on and on. I love this example. This is a series of modular paving pieces that actually can light up differently, can, quote, paint themselves differently so that you can re-lane a road. You can reset the way people are moving on that road. You can establish bike lanes that can be moved to other places. So it adapts over time. And so those modules literally are changeable as the city changes around you. And then things like this, luminescent paving that just gathers light during the day and lights it up at night. And so we're seeing this more in Europe right now, but it'll find its way into this country very quickly. And then eight is green infrastructure. Now, those are those green landscape solutions that solve things like chemical contamination, street runoff, water retention, flood control, and so increasing. And we see this along the cultural trail with grain gardens and other types of applications. Increasingly, that'll be the norm, is to think about all of the urban landscape as solving problems, not creating problems. Nine is urban agriculture. Looking at production, processing of local food that combats food deserts, doesn't make us as relying as much on the grocery supply chains and the inevitable interruptions that we'll be seeing of that supply chain in the future. And also it builds community. So Indianapolis is rich and getting richer in this particular area. And then finally, looking at live, work, play, the blurring of lines. So I'm referring here to MIT, which has some labs that are looking at the future and looking at the way that things might go together differently in the future. The nature of work is changing. Since we are now in this mobile environment, we're untethered and the Internet of Things and the connectivity opens up doors for things to shift in the way our cities go together. So they're saying the traditional office building is going to become rapidly obsolete as a place for personal work. In other words, dedicated space that goes dark at night, isn't used for anything other than gathering from 8 to 5. That is trying to shift. Boundaries between home and workplace are dissolving. We're seeing some prototypes of personalized, transformable urban housing so that the user in that house can change their environment, can adapt it to working at home, or can modify it, suiting that season in their life in terms of work, play, living. And then time shifting, so sharing space on demand for collaborative work, so pop-up spaces, places where you can have business meetings, meet with some collaborators, and then go about your way, and that space turns into something else. And then finally, they also are focused on that idea of modularized, personalized, hydroponic, aquaponic urban farming system, so generating some of your own resources, and that becomes more a part of what you do in your daily life. So, 10 things to riff off of, and with that, I'm going to ask these guys what their thoughts are about any of those, or anything that we've forgotten, and give us a reaction.
I'm going to start with a question. How many of you are just starting your career right now? What's interesting is that 2050, 34 years from now, I might be dead. But I hope I'm retired by this point. In Boise, with Kristian, hanging out. But you're really starting your career at such an interesting time right now. I mean, some of the highlights that Dave just hit on just sort of scratches the surface, but to be kind of in this place at the start of your career is really, I think, an amazing, amazing opportunity for all the reasons that Dave kind of enumerated. So that's all I wanted to say. This is a really exciting time.
Actually, I've mentioned to some of the students who are here that 2045 or so, where will they be in their career? They're going to be at the height of impact in society. Okay, so at the most mature point. So that's the time, you know, that you're targeting for, that you'll have the most to say. And leading up to that, as you grow, you become kind of levers for change. So that's the way I think you should think about it.
So I think a lot of these, Indianapolis is in, we're in the conversation about a lot of these things going on right now. Sometimes I joke about, well, if climate change, when that happens, maybe we can have beachfront property in Indianapolis. That would be an enhancement. I'm an optimist, so I don't think about the extreme heat. I think about, we can have a beach finally. And I grew up in San Diego, so that's the way I think. But there's other, if there's that much population growth, which just seems ridiculous, and I haven't looked into where all that's coming from, but it seems seems horrible to me that we're going to have 9 to 11 billion. But if our city got twice as big, and we managed it well, that would probably be a good thing for us. Because right now, we, Central Indiana Community Foundation, and a lot of others are working on how do we get 50,000 more people living in Indianapolis who make $50,000 a year or more, so that would solve our revenue, our structural deficit of the city. That would, right now we have a $50 million a year structural deficit. The city has in its budget, which means it has almost no money for parks, no money for placemaking, no money for so many things that we all might care about. But if we had 50,000 more people, we could kind of figure that out. And if we had 500,000 more people and managed it well and created density, we could actually have the money to do a lot of great, great stuff. So some of those trends, I'd hate to think that I was in Los Angeles and I was going to double the population. That would scare the hell out of me. But doubling the population here in Indianapolis, you know, I think it's manageable. And then one last thing is, you know, there's, for 2 years we've been throwing this idea around about how to really integrate all of our transportation assets. And I know you're thinking, what transportation assets? That's the point, because I actually think by the fact that we're so far behind every city could give us we can leapfrog because we don't have legacy investments. I mean, my joke is, I'd hate to be, you know, Minneapolis St. Paul right now. We just spent $3 billion on light rail, because in 5 years, we, you know, people might just completely make light, not, they wouldn't make it irrelevant, but they could really make it seem like that was a bad $3 billion investment. And so I always pull this out because, you know, but now everyone, like, now everyone's talking about this. But I still think we have, Indianapolis could do something really interesting. I think we could take our assets, which are, we do have great bicycle infrastructure, the Cultural Trail, Pacers Bike Share, Blue Indy, still unique in America, and LA is just doing a bid, and they're going to have an electric car share, and Bolloré, who does us, is, I heard, is one of the two finalists. So, but right now, that's a unique asset. And then, you know, I'm excited about the Red Line and an enhanced Indigo. But how do we make it all integrated, all customer focused, put it on a real-time app? I want to go to Castleton right after this. I don't have a car. I have my own personal profile. Eric Tobias helped me think. A lot of people helped me. Mark Hill, but Eric Tobias had some great input on this. And I have my own profile. So my profile says, I want to see the option where I could ride my bike 1 to 3 miles every time I go someplace. I rode my bike over here. That's me. That wouldn't be your profile, but it's my profile. So I could, you know, and then if it's raining, it's like, then I can check off that, well, that's my profile, but delete bike riding.
But knows raining. If it's raining.
It knows it's raining. Yeah, so don't, yeah. It knows my tolerance of rain. If it's sprinkling, I'll ride my bike.
Bike rain's okay.
So anyway, but the point is, you know, I think the thing that we do extremely well in Indianapolis is work together in collaboration and partnership. So, I mean, I haven't talked to Blue Indy. I've talked to a lot of people about this. We have a task force. We're working on it. But we haven't gone to Blue Indy yet. So don't spoil us with Blue Indy. But, you know, they're a French company. You know, they're a French company. Are they gonna see the collaborative process of working in a Hoosier-like collaborative style?
You'll have to call them between 11 and 3.
But one simple thing is, I think every Blue Indy car should have a bike rack. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they should have a bike rack. So I'm riding my bike, it starts to rain, I pull over, I put my bike on the Blue Indy car, get in the Blue Indy car, and finish my journey, because now I don't want to ride my bike. So anyway, so we're working on that. So I think Indianapolis, you know, some of these things could be advantageous, some of these trends, and we'll have, some of them are incredibly challenging for everybody. And we're not just like waiting for this to happen. I think Indianapolis is thinking about many of these things in the right way. Mm-hmm.
Do any of you know about any comprehensive, beyond transportation, comprehensive smart city initiatives here?
Beyond
transportation. Beyond
transportation.
In Indy. In other words, looking at energy management, looking at other kinds of service delivery. Goldsmith wrote a book called The Responsive City, you know, working with New York. And, you know, talks about that kind of center-laden environment and making everything talk to each other.
You know, the city had a, did you work on that? The Smart Cities application? There was a Smart Cities application.
IBM.
We did not get it. We did not get it.
Austin.
But our focus, I think, was more transportation focused than anything else. Yeah. So that's, I know it from the transportation focus. So I don't know that we're leading in any of those other.
Well, I'll go off script. I don't know if I answer that question. But those 10 things you showed, I'm even worse than an optimist. I'm a capitalist, and I know that that the best businesses are built in down markets. So the greater kind of the external stressors, the bigger and more durable businesses can be built. Right, separates the wheat from the chaff, creates more opportunity. Blah 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 blah. So I look at all those things for the most part and think, somebody's going to build something big and durable that addresses those challenges individually. And I would say that the mega trends that were omitted from your top 10 list, and I don't blame you because they're a little bit more on the anthropological scale than maybe kind of traditional
physical design.
Yeah, but I think income disparity is going to play a huge role in how cities function in the future, and it's going to introduce, we're like on the tip of the iceberg in terms of many of the problems that will have to be addressed there. That's a big one. I think, and you kind of touched on this when you talk about IoT, but I would just say big data writ large. So the ability to parse and interpret and then make smart decisions, or dumb decisions, I guess that's up to the operator, based on that data. You know, the most powerful person in the world is someone who can tell the future. And the way, if you have enough data, you can get really, really close to telling the future. I mean, literally, if I knew the speed and relative position and state of every atom in the universe at any given time, I could tell you with a shocking level of acuity what's going to happen next, right? Is the meteor actually going to hit us? You know, is she going to kiss me back? You know, I mean, there's lots and lots of things that we can figure out. That. And so when we think about cities, when we think about big data, and you've heard this from me before, and you've heard this, and I'm glad we met, now you get to hear it. I believe that cities are businesses and citizens are customers, and that we're all ultimately in a pitched battle to win the talent wars. And talent, you know, Michael Dell's famous for saying that sales fixes everything, and I beg to differ. I think talent fixes everything. So the most dominant sports teams have the best talent. The greatest cities ultimately succeed in attracting and retaining the best talent. This is true for the minor leagues and the pros. This is true for small towns and big cities. It's true for nation states and empires. Winning talent is critical. And here's what people don't like. You know, most people don't like to dwell on worst case scenarios, which is why it's so easy to take advantage of people as a general rule. Talent is a zero sum game. Period, like hard stop. And there's folks that would argue with me about this, but I happen to believe they're wrong. Brian said, growing population in Indianapolis would be good. If the population doubled, that'd be great. That would be great if it doubled in a vacuum. If it's tripling everywhere else and it only doubles here, that's bad, we're losing. Right. If it doubles here, wallet doubles in Carmel and Fishers and everything else, because now we're still dealing with all the tourists who are working in the city but living in Fishers, and we still have this shortfall that you referenced earlier in terms of the donut. So,
there's all this data that also says it's not so much the number of people you have anymore; it's the talent of the people you have.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that could be a really politically incorrect conversation, mm-hmm. especially when you say you want 50,000 people who make $50,000 or more. Doesn't really address the equity.
Oh, it hits on all these hot buttons. Yeah, it hits on the income disparity thing, and who are we designing the city for? Mm-hmm. You know, but anyway, when we get into the big ideas piece, I tend to think purely around talent. So, how do we attract bigger, better, more dynamic? How do we bring more innovation with quotes around it into the city on the back of individuals? And I do believe that cities can be designed to do this, and I think that cities that begin, and I realize how gauche this sounds, so you can sit up there and judge me all day long, but if cities view themselves as businesses and citizens as customers, it becomes very easy at that point to begin to borrow best practices from other parts of the world, right? Industry in particular. And when we think about, again, you two both heard me say this, the guy I buy my air filters from online knows more about me as a human being than the mayor of Indianapolis, right? And I've hung out with the mayor of Indianapolis several times. and he knows less about me than the guy I buy my air filters from, right? Amazon knows a shocking amount about me, right? I mean, they know if I just moved or if I'm thinking about moving.
That's right.
You've all heard this example of the father who, the Target guy, right, who goes just batshit crazy with the Target marketing folks because they sent a diaper coupon to their daughter, and they were able to intuit that she was in fact with child based on her shopping habits over the preceding months. And marketers do this all the time. Google knows after 7 searches with a shocking level of accuracy your sexual orientation, your religious affiliation, your annual household income. Again, the city knows, it knows very little, right?
Even what they know, even what they have the data, they don't know. They have the data, but they don't know it.
Exactly.
Yeah, right.
So are we transitioning to big ideas?
All right,
so a city that, and we don't need sensors on every pothole in order to do this, right? I mean, you can tie that, as Brian alluded to, crap tons of this data is already out there, right? We have to figure out how to break down a few silos, and we have to generally probably wait a few more years until the general population is more comfortable with the outrageous invasion on their personal privacy that will be required to do this well. But they're already quite comfortable with it when it comes to shopping on Amazon, so I hope they can get comfortable with it when it comes to how they interact civically. But basically, marketing automation, sales automation, service automation at the municipal level. So the city knows exactly what I want, what I need, how I'm responding to the environment. Instead of just, hey, we've got a new app that allows you to report potholes as being kind of that state of the art in kind of cities leveraging technology, there's a way to craft a level of intimacy on an individual level for a city to be in deep relationship with the individual through technology. To me, that's what gets me excited, and I think that could serve as a powerful remedy to many of the challenges that you noted. Mm-hmm.
I have a question. Kristian, because of our strange willingness to share such information with Facebook, Google, Amazon, but we certainly have a wall up with government, Big Brother. So how does that barrier with, you know, government across the political spectrum keep us from reaching what you were describing, where a city could know what Amazon knows?
Yeah, I mean, the reason we're willing to deal either consciously or subconsciously, actively or tacitly with this. I'm a hardcore like capital L libertarian too. So like even as I say this, like it assaults like me on so many levels. It's hard to fathom. But I also get what's good for the goose is good for the gander. So you think about how this works in a commercial context with businesses and consumers, right? So Google, for example, right? Mm-hmm. Google knows what you're looking at.
Mm-hmm.
In case y'all don't know that, right? And it knows it forever, by the way, mm-hmm. right? So I'll give you like a really scary example. So you're at a hotel in some strange city, and you're on the internet and you're looking at something inappropriate, right? So it might be pornography on the left hand, or it might be anti-government, you know, anarchist stuff on the right hand side. Something that you probably don't want your mom to know you're looking at, or you don't want the feds to know you're looking at, or whatever. Eventually, that data doesn't go away. Today it's impossible, it's very, very difficult unless somebody was looking for a specific thing for them to tie you to that activity. But in the future, via quantum computing and the ready access to big data, people will be able to draw connections very, very quickly. They will know you were in that city 9 years ago, what your credit card number was, what the IP was for that particular connection, that particular room, and then the logs from the search engine. And then Google will say, no, that will never happen. But just know, theoretically, this can and almost certainly will happen, right? So we've already entered into this kind of implicit social contract with Google and with Amazon that you're going to provide some service to me, and in exchange for that, I'm going to just carve off a tiny slice of my soul. And I won't feel it incrementally over time. You know, I'll be dead inside, and then I'll know it. But we do this today, every day. We do it in lots and lots of ways. And we're mostly conscious of it, and we're willing to do it because we get value either in the short term or the long term that we believe is in excess of what we're giving up. Right?
Right?
That's why we fill out surveys.
The benefit.
It's the benefit.
It's the
right?
benefit.
So the city cannot just say, gimme, gimme, gimme.
Right.
It has to givey, 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 right? Mm-hmm. And it has to do it in such a way that at least the perception of that is it is in excess, right? The transfer mm-hmm. of value is in excess from what's being taken. Mm-hmm. Again, I think this is possible. Matter of fact, I think it's inevitable. Again, I won't go down too many like rabbit holes with this, but essentially it comes down to the transfer of value and getting value recognized. So if the city just takes information and it goes into this big, scary, you know, 2001 Space Odyssey box, that's bad, right? But if there's an immediate payoff and a long-term payoff that's articulated well, I think people will get comfortable. Because people are fundamentally motivated by
short-term value.
Yeah, I was going to say fear and greed, but you know, but if you can kind of tickle the reptilian part of people's brains, you can get them to do all sorts of unbelievable things, and ultimately that's what the city and the state and then ultimately the federal government will need to do, is show real value from the transfer.
What's interesting is that there is, I think, with cities, at least for a pretty significant chunk of the people that live and work somewhere, a lot of passion for that place. And so your point's really well taken in that there's already sort of an implanted loyalty to a community. I mean, we see it sort of every day, I think. People that love Indianapolis or love the greater Indianapolis community.
I named my son Indy, by the way, right? So, like,
I named my dog Indy.
Well, every one of my children are named after an animal, but so that's not a good question. But I think that's. I'm sorry for interrupting.
No,
I think
it's the time.
It's absolutely right, and I'll tell you, I'd love to get y'all's reaction to this. If you think this is a true statement or not, I think that the rise of loyalty and passion and interest in cities that we see all around us today, right? People from Cincinnati, there's all these rah-rah videos, and I mean even people like in Toledo, right? I think it's directly correlated, or there's an inverse correlation between that and the fall of patriotism. Mm-hmm. So as people have become less proud of being an American, they become more proud of being an Indianapolite or Little Rockian or Fayettevillian or whatever. Right. They're called, right? And I think those two things are like linked and inextricably. And I think it's not just a U.S. phenomenon. I think the global phenomenon that people have become less enchanted with flags, the flags of nations, and much more interested in city flags.
And just, a lot of that's related, I think, to place. They connect to place. So if you can tie this notion of connecting benefit relate that back to this loyalty platform that maybe needs to be leveraged more, then I think you really...
Do you think this is maybe the rise of the city state?
Or the return of the city state?
That's probably more accurate. I think so. I mean, a lot of the demographic stuff is showing this concentration of urbanization that's going to happen globally as well as nationally, and even we're seeing that within Indiana as well. Long-term projections are so. But I've got a question. And throw it out here: is that where are we going to put everybody? I mean, all these efficiencies that might come from tighter lanes and less parking and everything. I mean, there's some people that have done the math. I mean, not everybody's going to live in downtown Indianapolis or want to, I might add. So I think, you know, addressing some of this global population change that is we're going to feel here needs to extend beyond just the urban core to regional thinking. So our suburban communities also need to be part of this. So I think I think successful cities are going to mean successful regions and vice versa. Sorry, Michelle.
Well, I was just going to say, Jeff, I think bottom line though, we are, and maybe changing, but we are a bunch of individuals. Now, if you go to prior to 1944, the idea of urbanity, of shared space, you know, was very critical. And then somehow suburbanization happened and somehow became more I, than we, but although we're sort of going back to we, the question is, what does the people want in terms of shared activities or shared experience in the city? I wonder what your views are. We certainly want to bike together, you know, for example, but what might be the new or the future of shared space in the city? Whether it's in suburbia or not, I think it's much more the idea of urbanity versus sort of individual kind of people living next to, you know, literally next to each other, but not together, which is, I think, a two different way of living.
Let me ask you, this is like such a micro level of that, but how many of you have gone into a restaurant or pub and sat at the big community table. Yeah. You guys do that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've had, especially when I'm out of town, and just, you know, just idea like, you know, instead of eating by myself, which I would never, I know this is a trend, but I would never go into a nice restaurant and eat by myself because I get too bored with myself. And
you should call me.
I know. I know. Can I do that?
Yeah. Yes.
This is the city. You're halfway responsible for the 11 billion people. You got busy kids at home. So I can't call you at dinner time.
But that's a, that's this kind of, I think there's this, the bigger we get and the more the technology in kind of impacts our lives, I do think, and this is not a new idea, that the fact that we yearn more for personal connection, it's actually an opposite effect of what people thought was going to happen 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. And so, I think community is on a great growth trend. And as running Community Foundation, I'm really excited about that, you know, but I think people are finding community, whether it's online community, but I actually think there's still a lot of people who are looking for physical connection, you know, whether it's a restaurant and I don't want to eat by myself, or me and my buddy, it'd be fun to just talk to other people. And so we go to the community table and have, you know, a really great experience. And I think there's so many examples that we could think about how people are searching that out. You know, I mean, I get a huge kick out of not only taking Uber because it's so incredibly convenient, but unlike with my taxi driver in the past, I actually have great conversations with the Uber driver, right? I mean, you know, it's a whole different, there's something, you know,
right.
You know, it's just a different, there's a different expectation and culture.
Well, they don't hate their lives quite as much, too. Yeah. Uber drivers, they tend to initiate most of those conversations.
Yeah, they do. Yeah. I don't know. Uh-huh. I mean, it seems like, how do you make any money as an Uber driver these days? They keep lowering the price and doing discounts. I don't get it.
You want to know another megatrend? Another megatrend is by 20... I'm going to screw this up bad. Can I just make this number up, but it'll be directionally accurate?
Go for it.
All right.
Nobody's going to
Like by 2030, half of the U.S. population will be 1099 contractors, right?
Yeah.
So the rate at which people are, the gig economy would be a simpler way to put it, is just exploding. And it is going to continue to get bigger and bigger and bigger. And this plays into where do you live, where do you work, do you work for, where do I need to be on Monday versus where do I need to be on Wednesday?
The next couple of hours.
You know, I mean, I think a huge trend of that too, and I'm 57 years old, and I'm getting to be a little bit more, it's so funny that I'm actually leading a conversation on this, because I'm a very late adapter to every technology, but I'm getting a little bit more hip. But I actually think my timing is good. I will retire out of my job just at the same time that I become irrelevant because my skills don't match. I think about that a lot. Instead of thinking about acquiring the skills that would actually allow me to last longer, I think I'm just on the right trend. But by the time I become irrelevant, I need to retire. I'm ready to retire. But I think all of you know, and my son who's 17 and a half, I mean, you're going to have to develop such resiliency in skill sets. You're gonna have to adapt. I mean, I've been somewhat adaptable, and I think I've been somewhat resilient without being tested too often. But there's resiliency, I think, is a huge, I used to think of it as perseverance. I mean, that's what I always tell my son, you gotta persevere. When you're knocked down, you gotta get back up, emotionally, physically, whatever that is. But I think resiliency is different. And I think that's a huge theme, because if you're doing the gig economy, I mean, oh my gosh, I've spent a lot of time, we're looking at doing a big kind of new journalism project with a star. You know, if you're a star reporter, if you were a 57-year-old star reporter, they're not as lucky as me. They got irrelevant.
It's not
10
good.
Years. I mean, they've unless they're super resilient, they have been rendered irrelevant. So they're hiring all these people in their 20s, and you know, if you're a star reporter, how good of a writer you are is probably way down on the list. It's how many social media hits you can get from your how many clicks can you get on your online article. You have to be your own marketing person, your own social media person. You may have to create events. because if you're not creating events, you're not getting your brand out. You have to create your own brand. I mean, to be a star reporter.
Can you edit?
Oh yeah, can you create? You better be damn well. If you're a reporter or writer and you're not creating your own videos, you're screwed. No, you have to be so different than you were 10 years ago, and you have to be resilient and adaptable. And you know, this gig thing is, if you have to do gigs all the time, man, the marketplace is changing like this, right?
Yeah. So I want to get back to the idea of communities, because we are sensing that need for community. But when I think about community in the 1920s in this country, especially in urban areas, you're talking about, you know, I was in that tenement, the people in a four-block area, those were my people. And I come from immigrants that I totally identify to, you know, just one language being spoken in an area and everybody just bonding that way. Think about community today. You got your social media community, you got your hobby community. We're very transient. Nobody stays in one place for more than a few years. And so does that speak to, one, a capability that we can create multiple communities, and two, do those communities become as strong an identifier, as strong a driver? You know, the standard wisdom on social media is that your Facebook friends are not your friends, right? You know, they're just people out there. So where are your friends? And where are those people that you bond with, that you, you know, have their back? Are we looking at multiple facets of that now? You know, I've got one over here and I got one over here, and they do different things.
You know, so I have a theory. I mean, I don't do Facebook, and it's not because I can't figure out how to do it. I think I could. Maybe not. But my wife would help me. But the reason why I don't do Facebook is because I've been very thoughtful about this. I run a community foundation. We give away money. We're involved in lots of community projects. So I have a sphere of people I know in this community that is in, at least in the multiple hundreds of people that I have to, that I connect with, and that are important to me. And if I add on another outer sphere of Facebook friends, and I start getting people that want my time and attention from junior high, I already, my wife and I have this conversation all the time. And of all these people that we know, who, if we got in trouble, if we were really in trouble, who would we call? You know, I mean, and the thing is, my world is so big, but my friendships are not as deep as they used to be. When my world was smaller, my friendships were deeper. Mm-hmm. And I actually, we think about, how do we curate our real important friends? Mm-hmm. We have to curate that. We have to think about it more than we used to, because there's so many, and so Facebook gives you another world. But like you said, have you got in trouble, are they going to come to your rescue? I mean, I don't know. But I mean, mine aren't. My world's not.
Oh, it's not. I mean, you know, Malcolm Gladwell's never had an original thought, but he was very good at repeating others. So I can never remember who originally said something, but I can say Malcolm Gladwell wrote about.
You can be sure he did.
Yeah. And in that book, in a Tipping Point, when he references some actual scholars' work on what's the maximum number of relationships that a human brain is capable of managing in any kind of thoughtful sense. And it's pretty small. You know what I mean? I mean, I think the number was 150, and even that sounds probably, you know, a lot. Yeah, you got it. You should try doing this and then trying to live in two different places at the same time. Because I tell you, like, my main reason for kind of flipping the switch and coming back here was that I was incapable of actually investing in any relationships. Because between work, and you're in the relationship business, that's all we do. I need to meet new people to figure out, you know, who to bet on, right? And then the social noise, and the accessibility, so the fact that anyone can reach out and grab you and take a piece of your time and attention, it is so debilitating. You know, you were talking about the four square block area, I heard former governor of Florida, Martinez, who most of y'all are too young, but there used to be a rap band called Two Live Crew. And they actually had a song called F-U-C-K Martinez, and it was about him. Very nice guy, by the way. The Two Live Crew and him did not get along. He was the son of, I think, Cuban immigrants, and he said his whole life was on one block.
Yeah.
His apartment building, the community center, and when something went, and there was no government assistance in 1950 Miami for Cuban immigrants.
Yeah.
And he said, we never even thought about it, because if somebody got sick, or you couldn't make your payment, or whatever, you went to the, the community center was boom, and there was no shame involved in it, and there was no paperwork, you know, there were no docu-signs. Yeah. It just kind of happened. And I mean, I reckon those days are long gone, but boy, when I sit and dream about what's close to perfection, it looks something like that.
Yeah.
Let me build on that. So I found a statistic that net migration into the United States is going to come more from international migration versus natural increase by 2032. Okay, so that means that our population, we're already getting diverse, but the pace of that diversity is going to accelerate significantly. Another statistic that I found is that the young people below 18 years old, by 2018, that population below 18 years old is going to be shift from what we think of as the majority, which is us, to being the minority, which is everything other than us. So this diversity
in 5 years, if you're in high school, it's going, your world of high school will be a minority majority.
Right.
And then fast forward that another 5 to 10 years, and the workforce will be that. America won't be that until 2035,
right.
But so many parts of our major parts of society will be that before,
right.
Because you know what? It's gonna be over the 65, it's still white.
Right.
Everything else in 15, right. 20 years is gonna be minority majority.
So to kind of play that out to Dave's comment about community, what does that start to mean in terms of how we start to build bridges with people? How do we create new communities with people that are different than us,
mm-hmm.
right? And what does that start to look like, not just from a technology perspective, but also from a placemaking
right.
perspective?
Has anyone met anyone from Burma in
yes.
Indianapolis? You have?
Mm-hmm. Fort else? Wayne, actually.
Okay, because there's a huge Burmese population on the south side of Indianapolis, near Southport, huge. Most people in Indianapolis don't know that unless they're down there, and people on the north side don't know that.
Or unless you're taking a cab at the airport, mm-hmm. or
oh, right.
a lot of those folks have been cabbing, or you're eating in that neck of the woods, because a lot of them work in the restaurants.
So how does Indianapolis maybe be at the forefront? And we're not thought of as a place that's certainly welcoming in a lot of respects, given what's happened in the past, but how do we address that? Kind of going forward in terms of build a stronger community for a diversity of people, because that, nothing's going to change that trajectory. I mean, that is so big in terms of the composition of that population change. How do we capitalize on it? How do we extract the talent from that?
I want to go back to, because yeah. when Kristian said that talent, I think he's right, that talent attraction is a zero-sum game. But talent development is not. And the cities that are going to be able to take their immigrants and create not only a welcoming, but an equal opportunity, and I agree with you, Betsy, I think that's going to be the next theme of this century in the world and in this country. And I actually been thinking, I've been thinking that revolution is possible. And I think actually, in a way, we're seeing revolution politically right now,
yeah.
right? I mean, it's expressing itself a little bit. I thought it was going to come from the streets.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually coming from the streets and voters, but not in violence yet. But
right.
who knows? Well,
right.
it's kind of combined.
Yeah.
So, and actually, I hit this about a year and a half ago. I had lunches back to back with two very successful white male capitalists And I didn't bring it up, but the conversation was 2 days in a row, the people who are all about capitalism and have benefited from capitalism, they both independently said, you know what, I think we have a problem extreme differences in income and opportunity. What's the word?
Income disparity.
Income disparity. We have, they basically said, they both thought the biggest, this is gonna be a huge, huge problem for America, for their kids, and two capitalists basically said, you know what, I don't think, and this, and they both said this, I don't think capitalism can solve the problem.
So back to that population thing. The massive growth on that chart, there were two colors on the bar chart. The growth in the developed world is kind of doubling, but the big spike was in developing countries. Now, when you think about that, what's going on currently with refugees, with stresses on the environment, living on a dollar a day, that system looks broken now, but just double, triple, quadruple the number of people in those stressor situations, and we have chaos. We have perpetual revolution. Now, what I don't like to go there too quickly because we begin to think, all is lost, or we begin to think, well, let's just build the walls higher.
Everything gets reinvented. I mean, revolutions create destruction. And listen, our wasn't too long ago that our forefathers picked up guns and started killing people over taxes. Mm-hmm. It wasn't. That's it, right?
Yeah.
That was over taxes. So I think that's the thing. When it happens. And I just wonder. It's like capitalism. I'm pretty rah rah on that. I also realize that capitalism was perfect for the context in which it was born and flourished. And that context is changing. Mm. And therefore, I can say with some level of certitude that capitalism is not the answer in the future. And the same thing with what we've built here, do we just keep fighting? Mm-hmm.
So if you just take that thought a little further.
Or just lay down and let it wash over you.
Or back to your opening comment, in those darkest environments is that the most opportunity.
Yeah.
And so we are the least likely candidate, perhaps, for this because we're buffered here in the middle of the country with all of the values that make us up as Hoosiers. But what if this city in a developed world decided that we were going to say, I know there's a lot of refugees out there. I know there are a lot of folks who don't have the skill set, but we're going to have a hub that allows people to quickly accelerate to become useful citizens within the environment. And I mean, this would take a shift in our whole value system that has been so discriminatory in the past, but it's just, if we could embrace that and get comfortable with that idea, then we actually are betting on the horse that's winning, so to speak. We're actually saying we're linked to that world instead of isolating from that.
You're on the right side of history.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think the problem has to do with that you probably can run the world right now, our world, not underdeveloped world, the Western world, with maybe one third of the workforce that is required, right? And I would almost project that could go down to maybe 10% of the workforce and even more. And of course, as technology came by in the past, there was other jobs that came up, and of course we tell our folks here that we're training you for a job that we don't know how it's going to look like.
Thanks for
by the time. I didn't tell you at the time. But I think the problem is the whole concept of work. So the idea that I spend a certain amount of time and then I get so much silver that then I can take to Mark so that he can give me bread, that whole system is probably not going to work if two-thirds of the people are not necessarily needed, per se. And so I think that's kind of the problem right now, is to try to figure out, does the system have to change? That we're all like members in a club, is it going to be more membership? Is it going to be, I think those are the discussions that are going on right now.
I think that notion, though, has been debunked a little bit, not to be contentious, but the idea that as we innovate, we become so efficient that people don't kind of know what to do, anything to do anymore. And I mean, we've been innovating pretty hardcore since, 1600s, right? Big tectonic shifts in transportation, communication, machination, so on and so forth. Keep getting more and more efficient. And on a relative basis, really unemployment, or the fact that people are sitting around fallow, is no different than it was 100 years ago, right? I mean, there are certainly variances year over year, decade over decade. The counter argument is that those people are, there's new efficiencies which alleviate certain legacy vocations, free people up to pursue higher value.
Right.
Now, so here's where you and I would agree with you, is that I disagree on the fact they don't have anything to do, that the world can run on the, the problem is very rarely are they being shifted to higher value activities. There's a bifurcation where it goes one hardcore right. one way or hardcore yeah. the other. And that, of course, goes back to our income disparity conversation, and then it just snowballs, right? The flywheel gets spinning. The problem is, again, what do you do? Do we try to intentionally retard progress? That is largely an ineffective strategy, right? I mean, people try it. The landscape of history is littered with the dead bodies of despots and rulers and nation states that have tried to do that.
On an individual basis, you're right. If you think about the reporter that's 57 and could not accommodate the changes, but if you think about that as an overall system, that whole system of how journalism is achieved and what's looked for and how you're successful at it has adjusted and changed. Yeah. It still employs the same number of people, I would venture to guess.
Here's what happens, though. No. Here's what happens. I would argue that news is even more important today, the distribution and consumption of it, than it was 20 years ago, 50 years ago. It's even more valuable, right? People are more interested in it. However, the craft of creating it has actually been devalued. So the bifurcation still exists. So you're either a freedman that goes all the way to the right and becomes a multimillionaire, being the 1% of the 1% who can write New York Times bestsellers that stay on the list for 6 months, or you become a citizen journalist that is literally scraped. That's not a full-time job, right? You can't make a living doing it. I'll give you another example, photography. Has photography ever been more popular than it is today? Right? Has there ever been a worse time to be a professional photographer? Right? It's the exact same dynamic. Actually, if something becomes democratized and more popular, it becomes less viable as a vocation. And you see this bifurcation, where again, one of my best friends is a wedding photographer, God bless him. And, 15 years ago, every Saturday, he went and charged somebody $3,500 to take pictures at their wedding, right? And his competition was the other three guys on Main Street that did that for a living. Today, there is not a bride in America who does not have a sorority sister that also takes pictures of weddings, right? And she'll do it for $500, right? And here's the really scary part. According to my very good wedding photographer friend, they're 95% as good as he is, right? Because the technology
has
leveled the playing field. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the irony is, he is arguably more successful than he's ever been because he decided, I'm just going to start charging $20,000 to shoot a wedding, right? He decided to go, bam, up level, right? Whereas the other guy who's I'm just going to take more school pictures or more senior pictures or whatever else, got into big trouble. But you see this every time the means of production get democratized, the popularity of an industry expands radically, but the prospects of the average person or the middle of the bell curve vocationally being able to do that as a career.
So here's a question for everybody. Is it really that there are just so many challenges, or is the real challenge the pace of change? So we have the journalism as a great example. 15 years ago, 10 years ago, we aren't talking about this in journalism. the rise of the internet, the extensive, you know, everybody becomes a citizen journalist, changed. But if that were to happen more slowly, you'd have time to find the niches, time to re-identify. But now it's just like through the roof. And so how many places is that happening? And is our real challenge helping people to adjust more rapidly to the pace of change and finding opportunities more entrepreneurially as a gig economist person in that setting?
It's happening everywhere.
Yeah, so I think this, I just went to a really incredible conference about technology innovation and change, and networks. Networks, and I think networks are this very fascinating thing. And I've been thinking about this network idea, and I actually came back to that, you know, though I got a master's degree, though I've worked hard, every job I've ever had in my life, I got through a network. Yeah. That maybe my skill set, I mean, I got the opportunity to compete in a small sector of competitors because of my network, and then I maybe won it because of my background or experience or skill set or whatever. But what got me to the table for every job I ever had, my very first job, and my sister got me a job as a busboy, you know. Every job I ever had was network related. I didn't realize that until like the last month, right? And so,
Mr. Network.
Self-aware, right? But anyway, I know I've been doing networks all my life, but I didn't realize that it was my reason that I got to do stuff. That I was. I thought other people were dependent on it. Anyway, there's this thing about change. So, you know, I've always been fascinated that change. There's winners and losers in change, right? In every moment of change, there's winners and losers. And I mean, someone who had some star reporter, some 25-year-old who was a whiz kid writer and video shooter, he's won on this change because now the people in front of him that he was gonna have to wait 15 years to get by in seniority, they're gone and he's the hot guy. Yeah. He's the big winner and they're the big loser. But so often then we think about change as win or lose. But this conference and this great, and I can't remember the writer, but this thing was, that a lot of change can be win, 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 lose. 10 people can win, yeah. To one person. Yeah.
Somebody is losing though.
But someone's gonna lose. So my thought, and here's the way I think, is there either public policy or philanthropy, which is what I do for a business, that can mitigate the loser. I mean, not eradicate, but mitigate the loss. I mean, so right now, Carrier, mm-hmm. Carrier Corporation's going to Mexico with all their workers, and so all those people that are making, you know, what are they making? They're making $20 to $25 an hour, and without any kind of intervention, they're going to resurface at $12 an hour. That's gonna be devastating for all those families, right? I mean, it's gonna be devastating on your ego and your emotional state, your physical and mental health, and your family. And Hogsett and his team are trying to figure out, you know, how they're gonna intervene to mitigate. And so, but my main point is that I think the pace of change, you know, if you look at journalism from, you know, 1920 to 2000, you know, you could mark a lot of changes, right? I mean, at one time, you know, we had two, you know, we had an afternoon newspaper and a morning newspaper. We had multiple newspapers. One of the changes I love is that when I first moved here in 93, the Star, which was very conservative and I was not, had incredible power. And actually in the 1950s and 1960s, I read that if you wanted to do if I was trying to get the cultural trail, whatever the cultural trail issue was in 1960 in Indianapolis, if Eugene Pulliam didn't like the idea, forget about it. He basically had more power than the mayor of Indianapolis. Yeah. That's pathetic, right? I mean that's horrible in my book. So it's been, you can mark all these changes, but now the changes from 2000 to 2005, 2005 to 2010, 2010 to 2015, are in hyperspeed compared to the changes from, you know, every 5 years from 1920.
Yeah, but the bard who went around, singing tales in order to distribute, you know, tribal knowledge, when Gutenberg showed up, that blew his mind as well. All of these, like, so the rate of change, the cycle rate of change is decreasing, it is truncating. But every big innovation, I challenge y'all to challenge me on this, so get your thinking caps on, has been, when we think of the big innovations, the big technological shifts, okay, so fire, the wheel, I'm serious, the wheel, navigating open bodies of water, the printing press, locomotion, train, car, jet travel, the internet, they've all been network innovations. Every one of them is a network innovation. Every one of them lets you communicate faster, including fire. Because fire is one of the things that allowed us to preserve food in a way that we could travel further than the wheel, than the train, blah, blah, blah. Like this, it's there's a Moore's Law-like effect. You can't slow it down, right? And we talked about, I mentioned quantum computing earlier. We cannot even fathom what impact quantum computing is going to have on the next wave of innovation that will make today's technology look, you know, I mean, orders of magnitude. It's going to go faster and faster and faster and faster. So again, I think the cycle rate of change continues to truncate. I think there's no argument there, and there's literally nothing you can do about it, right? I mean, other than acknowledge it, like right. If someone could go write something about it. But I mean, there's a Moore's Law-like dynamic happening with this. And all of these big innovations are network innovations that speed my ability to transfer knowledge. It's almost unfathomable to think about what is next, since the world is at our fingertips right. with just a couple of seconds worth of work. But it's something, well, it is having questions answered before you pose the question.
Yeah. So that either drives us insane or we find a way to get more adaptable. And it either creates more separation between winners and losers, or we find a way to level the playing field. And I guess that's where I'm wondering, is there an opportunity, either as a city or as a subculture, to say, we want to be there so that people don't go crazy and so that there aren't big losers and just a few winners.
What I was going to point out when you were talking about that before is that a lot of the immigrant populations that have come to Indianapolis have found it or stayed because it's such an affordable place to live for the extremely high quality of life you get. And then they ride home and they bring all their family over and they become this family, close-knit group, and you could argue that that's completely in line with our Midwestern culture.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think that's an asset we can build on.
Yeah. Absolutely. Let me tell you a story. I teach English as a second language through my church to a group of Egyptian immigrants, and I live in Carmel. There's a large Egyptian population there. It started with one guy settled in Carmel, and then it's just it was the tipping point, and now. This community is building their own Coptic Christian church in Carmel as they have the money, so it's taking years for them to do it. But to your point, that is their community, that is where their culture is, that is where they feel safe, and that is where they are able to play by the rules that they understand. I was trying to help, I quickly got off of adverbs and adjectives with this gentleman I was working with and started talking about insurance and the license bureau and all of this stuff that's hard for all of us to navigate. Can you imagine somebody that speaks Arabic as their primary language? So I think but this gentleman that I happen to work with has an advanced degree in food technology, and he's a dishwasher. There's talent there that we're not able to capitalize on. There is a family man that, you know, can contribute greatly to society and to his community, but we don't have a way to help him. do that. Ellen.
I'm curious also, we've kind of tiptoed around it a little bit and talked about how most of the major advancements and technological changes have been a result of network. I wonder if there is a lack of network between the city and community and what role each of those entities should play in not only attracting talent but developing talent, and how that's going to play out in the future of Indianapolis and other cities. Like, what is the breakdown of the role that both the community and the city plays to develop talent and to bring talent? And then how do they work together to make that happen? Because it could be a problem of there not being an effort in tangent with both groups, you know, that's why it's not gaining a lot of traction.
We're going to need another panel for that one, because there's a lot, again, to me, I think that's like the number one opportunity, like hard stop. So how the city can become, how the city can become a talent factory, a talent attractor, a talent retainer. Of course, everyone talks, I mean, ever since, you know, rise of the creative class or whatever, people have to attract and retain them, blah, blah, blah. But there is, the answer is not more art galleries and dog parks, right? I mean, that may be a little bit of that, I guess. But someone kind of teased this out a second ago, and it's awesome, which is universities in the late 80s and the early 90s started launching these things called incubators, and they were largely a horrendous failure across the country. It was all about, if we can just get our smart professors and the guys who are in charge of commercializing IP into a pretty cool office with a coffee maker and some photocopy machines, and, you know, if we can get them in there, you know, because it's really all about the space, this is going to be great, right? We're going to make a bunch of money, we're going to become the next Stanford, and they were largely failures, with the exception of the one, you know, there's some like life science-y ones that have been relatively successful. So the universities today that are like kicking butt have decided to turn the entire university into the incubator, right? Instead of there being a building on the corner of campus, the whole Stanford is an incubator, right? I mean, there's so much so that there's been lots of like writing about, you know, is Stanford too close to the valley, right? I mean, that was the name of one of the articles, right? Mm-hmm. And the thing is, I can't tell where the university starts and, you know, what's going on. Exactly. The old university was about, we're going to teach you how to drive a car, and then you're going to go get your diploma, and that diploma is essentially a driver's license. Now, good luck getting a car, buddy. You know, but you can drive it if you can find it. You know, to me, the new university is you spend 4 years building a car, and instead of a driver's license, they give you the keys and you drive it off campus, right? You use that 4 years or 6 years or 9 years for you millennials to actually build your vocation. Right? Blow that out a little bit and think about the city as an incubator. And not in a flaky sense, in a literal sense. I mean, not in a conceptual sense, in a literal sense. Like, we get as literal as possible about creating a city that creates opportunity and creates jobs. Yep.
So, from a city perspective, 92% of the city's discretionary budget goes toward
public safety.
Which means that your D&D, your DPW, those that are place-making entities, organizations, agencies, don't have the funds to be able to do that. So it's not that the city doesn't want to do those things, they literally have no funds.
The city didn't want to do those things either, though. I mean, so you wouldn't solve this problem through trying to figure out how to eke out a few more bucks from the city anyway. Like, the city is the canvas. It's going to have to be other entities that activate it and enable it. You know, we never got to our big ideas for the city thing, but but something I pitched Brian on, he's not said yes yet, but I pitched him on. There's a guy named Paul Graham, who's a very famous technology essayist. He founded the accelerator Y Combinator, and he wrote an awesome essay on how, for the price of an NFL football stadium, you could be the number two startup ecosystem in the world behind Silicon Valley and maybe be within spitting distance. So for $1 billion, you could pay 1,000 of the best companies in the world $1 million to move to your city. That's an oversimplified view, But imagine for a minute, it's 1,000 companies with 5 to 10 of the smartest people in the world from Bangalore to Biloxi move to your city overnight, right? Let's say half of those companies go out of business in a year, but 10% of those companies grow by a factor of 10 over the next 4 or 5 years. 10 people become 100 people, 100, 1,000, 1,000, 10,000, a million. So huge population growth of the smartest people, high income, big wage earners that rent apartments, buy houses, buy cars, hire attorneys, PR firms, marketing companies. The concentric rings, it's explosive. This is just one example of using capital to turn your city into an incubator at an ultra-ambitious scale. You ask me, what's my one dream for Indy? My one dream is that our tolerance for risk goes way, 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 way up, and that our ambition level for what's possible, not being fast followers at a large scale. Brian did it with the cultural trail. He didn't cure cancer with it, but it was a big deal for Indy because it was so ambitious relative to other projects that had been attempted or not attempted because it was too ambitious.
And I would add, it was something that was done that had not been done somewhere else.
Exactly.
Right.
It was a
right.
It wasn't a fast follower
right.
thing. It was a.
But we
was
can't
bleeding.
Do that. Right.
So on that. So I. Yeah. I we'll do that.
I made a billion dollars.
I'm a Colts fan, and I actually do understand that the Colts build a sense of community, but when that whole thing went down, the Lucas Oil Stadium, it was going to be $500 million. I mean, I knew this wasn't going to happen, but I wanted so badly for us to say, screw you, NFL. We have the confidence that we're going to let you go. By the way, we're one of, you know, it's like there's 32 cities that have NFL teams, not all of which are the great cities of America, right? Mm-hmm. And there's great cities in America that don't have NFL teams. So there isn't a direct correlation, I don't think. Which I think sometimes we think that there is. Portland doesn't have an NFL team. It seems to be doing okay, right? And, so I wanted us to take that $500 million.
And build
that,
microbreweries,
that
just
we
like Portland.
That we weren't going to give to the Ursays. And that we were going to say, you know what? We're going to use that $500 million to develop our citizens through education. We're gonna really be all about developing our people. And we're gonna do it this way. And to have the confidence to say that. Now, I was just talking to a friend in St. Louis. They're losing their NFL team. They fought really hard. There's a sense of devastation about that. But there's a bunch of them, and they're not getting, that's it. I mean, that ship has sailed, right? But now they're turning that in. Let's take that $500 million, or I think even more, $1 billion now that we're going to have to give to the NFL or the whatever team they had over there, the Rams, I guess.
Yeah.
And and they haven't won since so long, I don't know their name. But that we're going to use that energy and that money to make ourselves truly a unique, differentiated 21st. Now, whether they get there or not, or they have the leadership to get there, I don't know. But that's not chasing all the other cities, what they think is the right, you know, is the safe thing to do. That's actually leapfrogging thought to every other city in America.
Leaning into something. And
yeah,
that's why the ambition level and
is
the
new distraction.
Yeah.
So, by the way, I'm a huge, I'm also a Colts fan, and not against the construction of the stadium. I'm just saying I need another $1 billion.
So what is the next cultural throw? And it doesn't have to be the same audience. It doesn't have to be.
Yeah, no, I know. You know what? If Indianapolis, Central Indiana, could find a way to add unique value into creating opportunity for more people, I really do think that is. Going to be, I mean, I think that's emerging as the theme of America for the next 3 or 4 decades. And so I always believe in it. So I didn't grow up with artists, but I became surrounded by artists as a potential actor at UCLA. And actually before that, I studied acting. That's how I was going to be an actor. And through that, the value that I got that has informed my career ever since then, even though I didn't end up as a professional actor, was I was surrounded by artistic people. I believe every human being that's born is born, if they're healthy, coming out of, at birth, that they are inherently creative. And what happens is either the creativity gets beat out of them, or it gets nurtured. And I think generally you could take that and say, I think the ability, every human being has the ability to be developed into amazing human capital, and that either gets beat out of them or it gets nurtured. How do we nurture our people, whether they've moved here from Burma, or they've, it's not Burma anymore, is it Myanmar?
Myanmar.
Whether they move from some other country, or they're born on the south side of Indianapolis to citizens of Indianapolis of mixed race or whatever, how do we nurture the development of human capital? There's also the talent attraction retention aspect.
I love it.
But what city does that is going to have an incredible competitive advantage. Mm-hmm. Why can't we do
that? We kind of do it. Like there's some small levels and some important levels. I mean, first of all, on a per capita basis, if you draw a radius 300 miles in diameter around Indianapolis, I think we're number two in the country in terms of the volume of undergraduates we produce. You know that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So really, really high volume. We are cranking out, at least, and listen, I got a whole other diatribe about college. I won't get into that right now, but we do a good job.
You're always wasting your time.
And then at a micro scale, you've got things like the Orr Fellowship Program, which is I think it's just remarkable. I mean, it's tiny little thing.
Is it getting bigger? I mean, is there an attempt
to
scale it?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely, yeah.
But not scale.
Yeah.
But an intent, you can't scale, that's the problem. But we're doing a remarkable job there, but again, just, it's de minimis. It's a drop in the bucket. I'm getting really excited about this idea of, I would never say city as accelerator, because that sounds like the title of an academic paper. So blank as a blank, isn't that just so pretentious,
But it's important if you're going to get good SAT scores.
Okay, well, I guess so. But the idea, to your point, because attracting is important, I think it's actually a cheap and efficient way, and a short-term way to show progress, but the real juice is freaking growing your own, you know what I mean? And so I do think that growing and keeping your own could get really, really interesting. And where that intersects with the whole kind of immigrant crisis and our recent reputation for kind of stonewalling that, if you're kind of taking that and flipping it around 180 degrees, is, you should do that.
So two cities that I know really well, have studied, I have friends there, I spend a lot of time there, Portland and Denver. Huge talent attractor cities now. Not good at all about growing their own. They're not developing their own citizens at all.
Wow.
It's all about attraction and then retention. And it's actually Denver is Colorado is very Hispanic, but Portland is super white, right? Mm-hmm. Portland has no diversity. So Portland looks like they're doing really well right now, but we get another 10 years down the road where, minority majority happens, and that becomes the talent cultural base of America, and they're looking like, the Mennonites, mm-hmm. they're like this little white enclave that can't venture outside their own boundaries, right? I mean, I think in Portland, some people in Portland recognize this, their DNA, though, is not going to be easy to get them to adapt and be resilient in that changing world. So 20 years from now, Portland could be way on the wrong side of progressive and ambitious culture.
So is there a way to marry the gig economy where basically everybody's an entrepreneur, people are moving laterally, they're not climbing that ladder in one corporation, but they're just stacking things that interest them perhaps in an ideal world, and the data-driven city where we know that there are Coptic Egyptians of a certain size in Carmel, and we know that the Myanmar people are of a certain size, but we also know what they need, what they're interested in, value systems, and potentially how they might fit into the rest of the COGS.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so now all of a sudden we have the data that demystifies, maybe takes some of the fear away, and begins to help people find the pathway into adaptation. And it, you know, and then all of a sudden that guy's degree has some meaning because we're networking. I mean, is that a move?
Connecting the dots from the data that you're getting, and then figuring out how to build the social network, person-to-person network, mm-hmm. that could actually, you know, it's like not just Jeff knows this guy through his church. There's a mechanism that we know that guy and other, what their talent bases are. We have that kind of data. How do we connect that and help build a larger network?
And does artificial intelligence help that accelerate?
You said you're a capitalist with a capital C. To me, that's so exciting from a positioning standpoint for this region, this community, as a way to develop the tools to do that, because all communities are eventually going to, I mean, everybody's kind of heading in that direction. They don't know how to do it. But what if Indianapolis created the platform that allowed that to happen?
Well, let's see. What if the city that's famous for being the marketing technology capital mm-hmm. of the world figured out a way to apply that same precept to?
You just need $1 billion.
You don't need $1 billion. You don't need $1 billion for the second big idea. Which, you know, so, you know, we've talked about this before. The ability, basically, I like to duck hunt, and like a duck hunter's dream is to shoot a banded bird. So that's a bird that has a little lead band around its ankle, essentially. That means that it was tagged at birth somewhere in Manitoba, probably. And they use it, and you call it in, and you say, oh, I shot a mallard hen in Stuttgart, Arkansas at 6:30 a.m. And I'm you're helping these wildlife biologists understand migration patterns and how many have been taken down so they can adjust.
Sounds like rationalization limits to me.
it's not rational. I mean, I would duck hunt without bands. It's very, but don't get me started. I got a very good argument for that too. But I believe we should do the same thing with our talent, and that we should start paying attention to who everybody is in Indiana.
Yeah. And shoot them. Band them and find out where they came from by shooting them?
We should band them. Think about this. If what's your name?
Mark,
if you had been in a relationship with the city, let's say from sixth grade, mm-hmm. the mayor wrote you a letter, was like, hey, congratulations on winning the state lacrosse championship. You know, that's really cool. We're starting a program where we want to kind of better understand the youth of Indiana, and I'd like to invite you to a reception next Friday night and ask you to join this Indiana Young Fellows program, right? And you're like, okay, you know, that sounds cool. And every year, the city or the state is collecting information on you, a non-threatening, fairly innocuous, what are you interested in, mm-hmm. who's your favorite band, what do you want to be when you grow up? You know, and then now you're in college, and we know what you're majoring in, and we know that you changed majors 6 times, and we know that you went to the Career Day Fair, and you ended up accepting a position in Accenture at their Denver office, and we know 2 years after that, we asked you, hey, would you ever consider moving back to Indy? And you were like, yeah, I don't know, probably not, but thanks anyway. And 2 years later, we ask you the same question. And you're like, maybe someday if I have kids, because I just mm-hmm. got married. And 2 years later, we see that you just had your second kid. We also know that Salesforce has an opening for a director of XYZ. You're a manager of XYZ in Denver, right? And we're able to connect those two things, right? So imagine like career builder woven into every fiber of the city, right? So every opportunity, perfect world will never happen, but the dream would be if we got perfect at matching up opportunity. Mm-hmm. And that might be vocationally, that might be a volunteer opportunity, that, who knows, right? Mm-hmm. But that can be done. Now, again, we can't do it perfectly, but we could do it really, we get 90% of the way there without having to rely on any kind of Star Trek stuff, right? Mm-hmm. Just what we've got today. And is there any reason why Indy shouldn't be leading that? I mean, it would be the biggest, it would transform the city. The mayor of our city, if he elected to do this, would be on the cover of Wired magazine. It would be that big a deal. You know, if this city said, we're going to, in the most profound way possible, not just reporting potholes, we are going to connect with our citizenry. We're going to connect them with philanthropic opportunities, volunteer opportunities, vocational opportunities. I'm not saying it's going to be easy, but it's possible. And it'd be so exciting if somebody would sign up for that.
I just wanted to go back to, at the beginning of the conversation, you guys were talking about people craving for connection, and we live in a disconnected world, but we're hyper-connected through social media, which arguably is not connected at all. So through this program, you would actually be connecting people in a way that they haven't been connected at all before, but would actually help them to find community.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Real meaningful community.
Meaningful. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's 7 o'clock. Turned around.
He had a hard stop.
Boom. Final. Did you take a call?
That is a baller move, by the way. When the phone rings and you just kind of walk off the day. You know, true story. I was speaking at the Central Library once. I'm at this podium and I've got my phone in my back pocket and I'm vibrate and it starts vibrating, and it does not stop vibrating. Whoever is calling me is
really wants to
just really wants to talk to me. And I look down, and it says, "Water broke." On the way to hospital. Now, she was in Little Rock, Arkansas. I was in Indianapolis, Indiana. So that was the one time I literally walked off stage. I was like, hold on 1 second. And then I never came back. I apologized to the organizer. And I called my wife and I was like, honey, I didn't know, was this really imminent? She said, do not go back and get your luggage. Go straight to the airport. I booked you a ticket.
Wow.
That was my wife.
That's your wife. The water broke it. She was booking you a ticket.
That is my wife.
Wow. So, final thought.
I missed something really good. Everyone was like laughing over here. So sorry, I missed that.
No.
Is that you, Jeff?
We weren't talking about you or anything like that. No, Kristian
was. I was telling
us about the story.
So, final thoughts. If we were, I think we've got some pretty rich areas that seem to have some meat to it. Anything we've forgotten or anything else that would be topic for another panel? I mean, obviously the disparity issue is one.
Mm-hmm. I've been going to a lot of conferences lately. I got to stay home and do my job soon, otherwise I'll be out of a job. But I've been to some fascinating conferences.
You can just hang out a few more years and we'll have
exactly. And this guy who actually worked for Apple, and then worked for IDEO, and then now I don't know what happened. Now he's a professor and runs a center at UC Davis. And he spoke, and he's done this incredible kind of case study of penicillin, and how penicillin finally got commercialized and scaled. But penicillin, people knew the healing powers of molds and bread molds to 250 BC, according to this guy. Mm. But it was 1948 before it actually became really available to save lives in any modern way. But his whole point of that, and he said he started writing a book that had an opposite point, but this is what he learned, and this is what he uncovered accidentally, is that you can have ideas. Everyone has ideas. There's tons of ideas. But the true innovation, according to him, is the network. And I kind of replayed that through my cultural trail experience of 11 years. I was really hoping that the cultural trail could show people in Indianapolis, if you have a big idea,
you can get it done because of Indianapolis is open and special and there's partnerships. But when I went deeper into that, if I had, I used to be the managing director of the IOT. And so, and I had access, some access to the community leadership world as the managing director of the IOT. But if I had this idea when I was still managing director of the IOT, I never would have been able to get any real movement on the cultural trail. So how did it happen? I was in a position hired at the Community Foundation and my network got a lot bigger and I got good at working it. But ultimately, the cultural trail idea, which I always thought the idea was the really interesting thing, it was actually, I think he's right, I think it was actually the network. Yeah. So I just think that, you know, that's something that I think we all need to think about, you know, you can have ideas, you can have this knowledge. I think the world is connecting the dots. And there's, you know, and that's the knowledge, you have to have knowledge and data to, you know, and information to connect the dots, but ultimately to connect them in a way that builds anything, it's your network. I mean, that's what I'm playing around with.
Yeah, so I think it's true. And I'll tell you what, networks compound the same way interest in your IRA compounds. Mm-hmm. And if I have a regret, which is that I did not invest in that deeply early, partly because I felt like the whole notion of it was kind of icky and ran away from it. And it's a deep regret I have not taking advantage of people's generosity and willingness to help me earlier in my career.
Back to that, the other thing that has been so profound to me within the last 5 years of my life is that, and this is the best advice, there's two pieces of advice I think are so important that I know. One is if you're gonna ever do anything with public art, call it temporary. Never say it's a permanent piece of public art. It's completely, and, you know, temporary could be 20 years, it could be 100 years.
Somebody tweet
just
that.
Call it temporary. The other thing is, I, kind of like you, I woke up one day and I thought, how come I never had any cool mentors?
We've talked about
it. We have talked about it. Well, this is because it's profound to me. It's like, I was so pissed off that I never had any mentors. And I see all these people have really great mentors. And you know what? I realized it's because every time someone like Mark Hill could have been my mentor, but I was so out to prove that I was his peer.
Yeah.
So every time someone wanted to mentor me, I think, or was available to mentor me, my ego said, I'm gonna be your peer. And I'm gonna show you how I'm your peer. And I didn't allow any mentors to happen. And you know, that's my, what's your deep regret?
Oh my God, that's a whole nother 2 hours.
So maybe strengthening network, whatever that mystical thing is, fits into this mold also. Strengthening network for everybody, not just people who have easy access, but broadening the access.
Right.
Mentoring people into the connectivity.
How do we get equity built into networks, right? How do we actually, if we're going to care about equal opportunities, how do we actually take our networks into that world? Yeah.
So really, the city has to be a network amplifier.
Right.
In a way, like if it is designed to actually create network and allow network to flow like water.
That's what the cultural trail, I mean, the cultural trail.
That's what you did.
It's a physical network.
I mean, it's a physical network. Yeah.
Right, but it can't be, to your point, the building with the coffee bar and the ping pong table.
No.
You know, hipster stuff. It's much more pervasive than that. It has to be a variety of places and spaces that's supported by a culture that allows network to
It's a psychographic shift. And there was a professor who was studying what he called innovation indexes. I'm like Malcolm Gladwell, I don't know his name, but you can Google it. And he was comparing, at the time, Cincinnati, Ohio to San Francisco. And he was looking at things like how many patents were filed in that city in a given year, and advanced degrees, and all this other. But he said, like, the most telling predictor of success was the distance between network nodes. Mm-hmm. So in Cincinnati, if you look today, it was this dense web of red, just dots that did like this, mm-hmm. but very little that went outside of the city. Silicon Valley looked like the opposite, right? It was not a ton of, well, I'm certain there was also a ton of interconnectedness, but it was so broad and so diverse, like literally the relationships, and I don't know if he used LinkedIn or social networks or however he mapped it, but again, like the ability, the psychographic shift required, this goes back to a big dream for Indy is higher tolerance for risk, bigger ambition level, right? And that ultimately gets enabled, I think, by who people know, who they're connected with, who they're enabled to connect with. The willingness of folks like you two to spend some of your relational capital to bring other people to the table. And I don't think there's a building you can build, and I don't think there's a certain type of streetscape you can design, or enough art galleries to do that. I don't actually know how you do it. I don't know.
Just to support your point on that, though, there is data that shows that, and call them nodes, whatever, but they are these hubs of places that stuff happens in a community. And we in Indianapolis are getting more of those. Mm-hmm. That are becoming more vibrant, and we need mm-hmm. to keep doing it. Frankly, it's been very organic and very grassroots. There's not been, I don't think, a strategy around that, particularly that's tied to this notion of innovation and this big thinking that you're really bringing to the conversation. But there is a direct correlation between place, physical place, mm-hmm. and what we're talking about in terms of
I did forget
of
about
innovation.
I guess that's one good micro example.
That's part of it.
But it's not a citywide strategy, and that becomes pretty incestuous pretty quickly as well. But yeah, I think you're correct, which is there.
Yes.
My wife's in town, and I told her I'd
get out of here.
Tonight.
Get out of here.
Her water's not breaking.
Get out of here.
So her water is not breaking, which is good news.
Tell her I said hi.
I will.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Sorry, I got to see you.
No, it's okay. Yeah, let's catch up.